Benvenuti alla Casa Italiana Zerilli Marimoda della New York University. We're delighted to have you here. This big crowd cheering for our guest, Salvatore Esposito, that doesn't need a presentation, but we'll have somebody present him anyway. The structure of the evening is very easy. First, I'm giving you a welcome and I'm acknowledging the presence and the work that Rosario Procino of Ribalta did to put this event together. Where is Rosario? Somewhere? Yeah, grazie. And I take this opportunity to thank Rosario and Ribalta for all they do for Casa Italiana. They are not only our neighbors, but we are good neighbors who love each other. And thank you. And immediately after my welcome, that is now, I'm going to ask Alessandro Iovino to introduce our guest. We are going to see a clip of a few minutes, and then we're going to finally bring Salvatore on the stage with Angela Vitaliano and myself. And we're going to drill him with a few questions, ma anche voi ovviamente gli farete le vostre domande. Per cui, senza indugi ulteriori, vorrei chiedere ad Alessandro Iovino di presentare Salvatore. Alessandro è uno scrittore, ha scritto molto prolifico, soprattutto di biografie, e resterete sorpresi dalla varietà. Si va da Bud Spencer a Berlusconi, a Licio Gelli, Andreotti. Per cui, fra politica, potere... Ma stasera è qui per presentarci il suo amico Salvatore Esposito. Alessandro.
Caro direttore, caro presidente, grazie. Non parlo in inglese non perché vi voglio mancare di rispetto, ma perché scrivendo un libro, 15 anzi ne ho scritti, ma non ho avuto, diciamo, il tempo e la concentrazione per imparare l'inglese. Mi perdonate, diciamo, che questo, diciamo, forse è un mio difetto, ma lasciatemi dire che ci troviamo nella Casa Italiana e quindi, diciamo, stasera mi sento meno obbligato del solito. Siamo onorati di essere qui con voi, vedervi così numerosi è un bell'impatto. Credo che con il mio amico Rosario possiamo dire che ci siamo un po' riusciti, con la collaborazione del presidente della Casa Italiana, con l'amica Angela, di creare un ponte virtuale tra queste due città, Napoli e New York. Rosario è un po' il megafono della comunità napoletana in questa meravigliosa città, ed è bello perché, e consentitemi di dirlo, della mia città, della città mia e di Salvatore, molto spesso, diciamo così, non trapelano sempre belle notizie. E ci siamo chiesti, ci siamo detti e abbiamo pensato, perché non parlare della storia di un ragazzo che ha studiato, che non voleva diventare un boss, come dice questo libro, ma che si è dedicato all'arte, alla cultura, con impegno, dedizione e passione. Questa è una storia che meritava di essere conosciuta da voi, che siete la splendida comunità, credo, italiana, in questa meravigliosa città che è un po' il cuore del mondo, non solo dell'America. Quindi telegraficamente concludo dicendo che speriamo, pensiamo che questo sia un po' un esperimento, un laboratorio che possa continuare a promuovere questa collaborazione. È vero, Rosario, non abbiamo, come dire, limiti culturali, artistici. Credo siate d'accordo con noi che tutte queste storie, queste biografie vadano, come dire, alimentate, conosciute. Mi rifaccio a una domanda che fece a Bud Spencer, che credo voi conosciate. È stato un grande attore, diciamo, scomparso qualche anno fa. E lui aveva viaggiato veramente il mondo, aveva visto, girato anche dei film qui nel mondo, e aveva un'ammirazione anche per Salvatore. Poi non abbiamo fatto in tempo, diciamo, a farli conoscere, perché purtroppo Bud è andato via. Però lui diceva: io ho girato il mondo, ma quando ritorno a Napoli e vedo che la Pippo co fumma cop, che tradotto, che cos'è la Pippo co fumma cop? Il Vesuvio. Io, il mio cuore batte come quando ero piccolino. Quindi, con una nota romantica, consentiteci anche di ricordare con commozione e affetto anche la nostra città, dalla quale io e Salvatore orgogliosamente proveniamo, che è la bella, splendida e spero amata per voi, Napoli. Grazie a tutti. E a proposito, vieni, Salvatore. Introdurre Salvatore, l'ho detto, per me è un onore, siamo amici e questa è la cosa più importante. Io credo che tra le amicizie con le amicizie possano nascere le migliori cose. Salvatore, diciamo, in questo momento è un attore, diciamo, ormai ha superato la fase, no, di attore emergente, un attore affermato nel panorama nazionale ed internazionale per questa interpretazione di Gomorra, ma qualcosa credo che Angela dirà anche lei dopo, perché qui ci troviamo davanti a un artista che va anche oltre Gomorra, ovviamente, e ha una carriera in questo momento attiva, è stato qualche settimana fa a Los Angeles, adesso qui a New York, ha scritto questo libro. Quando ci siamo parlati ho capito che lui teneva molto al messaggio che ha lanciato in questo libro e stasera siamo qui per condividerlo. Ho parlato troppo, vi ringrazio e adesso la parola al nostro grande Salvatore. Vediamo prima questa clip.
No, grazie, perché è bello vedere poi le reazioni nelle varie cose, anche agli spoiler, perché credo che qualcuno della terza stagione di Gomorra non l'avesse vista, però è molto più complessa di quello che sembra, quella cosa lì. È quello il finale, però dovete capire come ci si arriva, quindi vi emozionerà di più.
Magari partiamo un attimo dalla genesi di Gomorra, la serie televisiva, poi parliamo più approfonditamente di te, della tua carriera, eccetera. Allora, c'è il libro Gomorra di Roberto. Da quel libro viene fatto un film che si chiama Gomorra e dopo qualche anno arriva la serie, che col libro è lontanamente imparentata come ispirazione.
Anche col film, non c'entra praticamente, esatto, nulla.
Dici qualcosa di questa serie, che è diventata un successo esplosivo sia in Italia ma in tutto il mondo.
Sì, la serie, diciamo che le sceneggiature, il soggetto è supervisionato da Roberto Saviano e prende spunto dal libro per una piccolissima parte, soprattutto quella che riguarda Scampia. Poi è totalmente lontana dal film e di conseguenza anche dal resto del libro. E la genesi è abbastanza semplice, nel senso che questa serie racconta le dinamiche di una famiglia criminale, che è quella dei Savastano, e di quello poi che accade attorno a questa famiglia, le varie dinamiche poi criminali che accadono. Ma principalmente questa famiglia rappresenta un po' tutte le famiglie criminali del mondo, tutte le organizzazioni criminali nel mondo. Secondo me la cosa che è piaciuta tanto e che piace tanto è il fatto che sia raccontata su un determinato territorio, parlato in un determinato modo, e questo fa passare una veridicità, una realtà nel racconto, che poi, diciamo, è quello che credo sia stato il successo della serie.
Io faccio ancora una sola domanda, poi basta, perché Angela ne ha di bellissime e voi ne avete anche voi. Come lo dice il titolo del tuo libro, Non volevo diventare un boss. Sei un ragazzo di Napoli, di una famiglia normale, molto, con molto amore, mi sembra di capire, in questa famiglia, con figure di riferimento, il nonno, una serie di affetti molto veri, molto profondi. L'opposto di quello che si vede ritratto nei personaggi. Tu praticamente hai passato la vita a staccarti da quella realtà criminale che viene rappresentata nei film, e rappresenti la Napoli buona, certo, quella che ci piace, gentile, generosa, col cuore in mano, no? E poi ti metti a studiare molto seriamente teatro, perché dobbiamo dirlo, cioè non è che l'hanno preso dalla strada e poi l'hanno messo a fare Gomorra. Ha studiato per 3 anni in una scuola serissima a Roma. Diciamo il nome della tua maestra.
Beatrice Bracco, sì, che adesso non c'è più e che è stata fondamentale nella mia formazione come uomo e come artista.
E Beatrice ti ha formato come attore a tutto tondo, di teatro, di cinema. E tu fai tutta questa preparazione e poi ti ritrovi a dover rappresentare sullo schermo i personaggi agli antipodi di quelli che sei tu nella vita. Ma che effetto ti ha fatto?
Beh, è una cosa che io avevo messo in conto, cioè nel senso il mestiere dell'attore ti porta ad indossare varie maschere che possono raccontare il bene, come per esempio in Puoi baciare lo sposo, o il male, come per esempio in Gomorra, ma allo stesso tempo ti dà la possibilità, anche attraverso i ruoli negativi, di far trasparire anche un male così violento in modo tale da suscitare una reazione negativa nei confronti di chi ti guarda. E questo forse più cattivo sei, più terribile sei, più induci le persone magari a provare una sorta di schifo per le cose che fai, ma allo stesso tempo di fascinazione, perché il male nella storia della letteratura, della cinematografia di tutti i tempi, ha sempre portato una fascinazione del male nei personaggi negativi, ma non perché uno poi volesse essere quel tipo di personaggio, ma perché si viene affascinati, così come ne parlavamo prima dello studio, sul fatto che chiunque di noi venisse affascinato dai personaggi negativi, dalla tragedia greca, a Shakespeare, a tanti altri, al cinema stesso, che ti porta a chiederti ma perché questo fa queste cose così brutte? Nel senso che in un personaggio positivo tu già sai perché fa del bene. Nel male tu cerchi di capire perché una persona normale è indotta a commettere delle azioni terribili. E credo che queste continue domande che tu ti fai ti portano a provare una sorta di, ad essere affascinati dal voler capire il perché questa persona, questo personaggio, commette questi atti negativi. Così come un po' si è affascinati, credo anche qui in America, ma in Italia tantissimo, quando succede un omicidio efferato o quando c'è un atto violento che viene commesso, ci sono servizi, telegiornali, programmi. Non viene fatto un programma su un medico che salva una vita ad una persona, viene fatto un programma su un killer che ha ammazzato tutta la sua famiglia, per esempio. Perché le dinamiche di questi eventi negativi affascinano di più. Non c'è poco da fare.
E adesso non l'ho introdotta prima, adesso voglio farlo ufficialmente. Qua con me a conversare con Salvatore Esposito c'è Angela Vitaliano. Ha due titoli. Il primo è Napoletana, Doc. E per cui ha pieno diritto, sta lì. E il secondo è che è giornalista, bravissima intervistatrice, ultimamente soprattutto per Grazie, i suoi articoli sono usciti. Angela.
Che poi tra la miriade di coincidenze praticamente mia madre si chiama Assunta Vitaliano.
Perché studiando, perché studio, perché, allora confessiamo le cose, io prima di entrare qua mi ha già pigliato perdono di Salvatore, perché io non ho mai visto Gomorra, per una ragione che vi vado a spiegare prima che mi tirate le cose. Perché vorrei che anche Salvatore approfondisse questa cosa. Chi vive a Napoli, Napoli è tanta parte, incluso Secondigliano, Scampia e via dicendo, inevitabilmente ha conosciuto qualcuno che si è andato a comprare la roba là e non è tornato. Io ce l'ho uno che ci è andato e non è tornato. E non ce la faccio, ci sta chi guarda. È talmente tanto vero Gomorra che fai fatica a guardarlo, non perché non sia vero, ma proprio perché è tanto vero. Però poi ho deciso che valeva la pena stare qua, perché Salvatore mi avrebbe dato il perdono, perché lui ama Diego Armando Maradona e Diego Armando Maradona ha cantato tanti auguri a te, a me, al mio compleanno, insieme a Careca, a Giordano e a un po' di altra gente, quindi il perdono è stato concesso. Ma in un'altra vita io sono stata un'insegnante e i miei ragazzi abitavano in quelle zone e mi dicevano: professore, noi quando torniamo a casa non nasciamo più, stavo coprifuoco. Io vorrei che Salvatore Esposito, che ha scritto questo libro molto bello, molto positivo, in cui la scuola ha un'importanza non solo quella d'attore, ma la scuola, il convitto Emanuele, Vittorio Emanuele di Napoli, un'importanza fondamentale per onorare i miei studenti, che forse mi stanno guardando, cito solo Pino fra per tutti, che si sono diplomati, sono andati a scuola, hanno avuto bambini, non so tanto vecchio, però è così, e hanno resistito e vivevano lì. Vorrei che Salvatore raccontasse, per celebrare il bene anche, quanto sia duro e eroico resistere e quanto la scuola, la famiglia e le strutture sociali siano fondamentali per questo, perché non è solo quella Gomorra, Scampia è anche altro.
Qui si dovrebbe affrontare un discorso enorme, noi cerchiamo di limitarlo, nel senso che quello che viene raccontato in Gomorra, la serie soprattutto, è una grande metafora, una metafora sui sui tempi moderni, una metafora sulle organizzazioni criminali. A marzo in Italia esce la quarta stagione di Gomorra, qui in America so che siete solo alle prime due. Quando andrete più avanti, già con la terza, qualcosina l'avete vista, vi renderete conto di quanto i protagonisti della serie, i personaggi negativi che tutti che noi raccontiamo, chi più o chi meno subiscono o delle gravissime perdite o vanno in galera o muoiono. E quindi spesso il tema della mitizzazione che viene tanto tenuta in considerazione da alcuni giornali o da alcune persone a Napoli finisce per sgonfiarsi come uno di quei palloncini che quando si sgonfia fa la pernacchia, perché quello che viene raccontato in Gomorra è una grande discesa verso gli inferi di ogni personaggio. Partendo da un presupposto che la serie, i fatti e gli eventi di finzione che vedete all'interno della serie prendono spunto però dalla realtà, e di conseguenza se si vuole attribuire a Gomorra un potere di mitizzazione si cade nel banale, si diventa quasi degli stupidi, perché è Gomorra che racconta le sue storie in base ad una realtà già vissuta. E quindi di conseguenza è impossibile che crei una mitizzazione, qualcosa che racconta una cosa già avvenuta. Cioè la mitizzazione per una formula matematica è alla radice, non nel mezzo. Però questo, come dicevo, è un discorso molto ampio. Le periferie, che sono anche qui a New York, per esempio, ci sono zone abbandonate a loro stesse, delle zone che devono affidarsi alle opere di qualche associazione, di qualche fondazione. Beh, in Italia è la stessa identica cosa, in Francia è la stessa identica cosa, in Germania è la stessa identica cosa, ovunque. Per questo dicevo che Gomorra è una grande metafora, perché io personalmente, come ho scritto nel libro, ho avuto la fortuna di avere alle mie spalle una famiglia forte, una famiglia che quando c'è stato il momento di dire ok, se fai questa scelta le conseguenze sono queste, se fai invece quest'altra scelta queste sono le conseguenze, mi mettevano di fronte ad una realtà lasciandomi il libero arbitrio. Sono stato poi io a voler inseguire il mio sogno, la mia passione, ma è inutile negare che in determinati contesti, quando sei da solo perché non c'è lo Stato, non ci sono le istituzioni, le scuole, purtroppo io gli insegnanti ho sempre detto in alcune zone sono dei missionari perché sono abbandonati a loro stessi, non hanno, almeno in Italia, in alcune periferie non ci sono i gessetti, le lavagne, cioè gli insegnanti fanno un lavoro quasi disumano per poter salvare questi ragazzi. E spesso che cosa accade? Che molti di questi ragazzi, che non hanno la mia stessa fortuna, non hanno una famiglia forte alle spalle, finiscono per allungare la mano per chiedere aiuto. E la prima mano che trovano è quella del male. E questo è il vero problema. Quando la prima mano che dovrebbe trovare ogni ragazzino da solo, dovrebbe essere quella delle istituzioni, quello dello Stato che dice adesso ti prendo io, ti proteggo io, ti faccio crescere io, e invece questa mano non la trovano in nessuna parte del mondo. E questo è il vero problema. Non si può dare la colpa alla letteratura, al cinema, alle serie TV, alla musica, se un ragazzino inizia a drogarsi, inizia a spacciare, inizia ad ammazzare persone. Il problema è molto più profondo. Il problema nasce nelle famiglie, nasce nella crescita di questo ragazzo, nasce nell'assenza delle istituzioni e nell'assenza dello Stato. Poi viene tutto il resto.
It doesn't seem like it, but there is a direction of this, and they tell me we announced this event in English and you guys are speaking in Italian. I'm reading it right now. So maybe a couple of questions.
Oh, okay, 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 okay. Also because so it's a little bit difficult if I have to translate all the things that I say.
No. Okay. We move on. And
okay.
Maybe
okay.
A couple of
okay.
questions in English.
Maybe a short question.
Maybe a short question. And you have already shown in the films that you can act in French and Spanish.
Yeah, in English too. But and if I have to talk about a lot of things, it's quite difficult.
I understand that foreign languages were one of your favorite subjects in school. Yep. And that's where you started studying the language.
Of course, yeah.
And they still are.
Yeah, I'm working on it.
Tell us something about your American film myth. Who are your actors, idols, the ones you admire the most?
Well, you know, I was grew up watching movie like Godfather, Scarface, and I don't kill anybody, you know. And it's funny because if somebody asks me what kind of character you want to do in an American movie, and I say or a killer or a superhero, you know, and I say okay, for me it would be amazing working in a movie like Marvel or DC Comics or in movies like Godfather, you know, and people say oh it's two different characters, and I say, okay, this is the best of to be an actor because you can do a lot of things. You watch in my showreel a lot of different characters because I love to talk about a lot of things. For example, the last movie is a movie about a gay wedding. That in Italy, I don't know if in USA too. In Italy, it's. An art situation, you know, because we have the church. So think about two men or two women that goes married. Mm-hmm. It's
problematic.
Right now, the situation.
There are civil unions right now.
But you know, because I'm a Catholic, mm-hmm. I believe in God. I believe in the church. But I think that the most important thing that God gives us is the love. So if a person love a man, love another man, or a woman love another woman, it's just love. That's the point.
I would say his English is pretty good, even when he talks about deep concept,
right? Thank you so much.
And Salvatore, but talking about that film, you are an incredibly good comic actor. You made us all laugh, like three lines and the faces. Yeah, it seems like an instinctive talent. To make people, don't you want to do that more? Don't you want to make people laugh more?
Yeah, I love when
was Totò.
Yeah. Totò is one of the greatest. Masker in Italian.
Diciamo. Character actor.
Character actor Napolitan, but I think it's one of the greatest because he do a lot of characters and. Behind his job or behind his movies, funny movies, he talk about a lot of very, very interesting situation of the nation about, I don't know, the 50 or 60, yeah. Mm-hmm. And I know that the actor studios here in New York, in LA, study his characters and the characters of the script of Eduardo De Filippo, for example. That's an honor for us, like Napolitans, I think.
Angela?
And we have also in common the fact that we both like Ninillo Natale in Casa Cupillo.
I think that every Napolitan guy when is.
And we had all this tradition growing up that we were forced on Christmas to watch Natale in Casa Cupillo. Yeah. Yeah. That was, you know, like.
Non mi piace
presepe.
Excuse my accent.
And talking about.
It's like my English.
Talking about how good you are also as, you know. To make laugh. I watched and I was laughing.
We are talking in English because we saw a lot of people that go.
Because they told me. Promised the.
Okay.
When we move to the questions of the audience, you ask the question in Italian. Salvatore is going to reply in Italian. In English.
No, I hope that the Italian people understand the English. Okay. No, I don't know.
They're here. They live here.
Ma c'è qualche italiano che non capisce che non afferra in inglese, no? Tutti. Okay, perfect. We can talk in English.
Okay, so first of all, I watched a few episodes because I really wanted to see, and I was amazed by the transformation of Jenny Savastano from before Honduras and after Honduras, and that is a proof of actor that is great.
Thanks.
So, honestly. And this morning also, and I was really laughing like crazy, walking the street, people were watching at me. Because Salvatore was a special guest in these episodes of a parody of Gomorrah that is made by the Jekyll, and I want you to watch that because it's amazing. And he's, Salvatore says in the book that he refused to be in the first episodes because he was not sure how it was going to be. And then he saw the first episode that you have to watch, and he says, okay, knock, knock, I want to be in the second one. And it is hilarious. But how important is also, because in the third episode there is also Roberto Saviano. So how important is also to make people laugh about mobster and crime and this stai senza pensier. And by the way, if somebody tell you stai senza pensier, you have to start to worry.
It's like a thing, say without trouble, or forget about it, you know, something like that. You say, oh, okay, that's a problem, I have to pay attention. No, I think that if you make people loud, you win. In every moment, in every time, in every movie, because there's a lot of problem down the street or in our life. So a laugh save your life, I think. So for an actor, it's the best thing. And it's the most difficult thing, say, I think, make loud people, because it's for a loud, I watched a study that say for a loud, there's a lot of muscle in your face that is going to move. For crying, it's just, for July, it's difficult because start everything from the mind and then comes to the smile. So it's more difficult for an actor. So I'm proud when people laugh of Vuoi baciare lo sposo on the Jackal episode, because I'm happy too. So.
And it's also nice for a Neapolitan like me when you can laugh without the stereotypical thing. You know, this is why we love also Massimo Troisi, that we miss so much, because he was able to make us laugh without the stereotype of the Neapolitan, you know, but with the intelligence of Neapolitan people. And also Gomorrah is very modern. We were talking about,
but it's like here in USA. Because if you talk with somebody, say, oh, you're Italian, oh, yo, pizza, mandolino, like no, like if, I think that people that comes in Italy and wait all the person around them, they say, oh, pizza, mandolino, every day. I just want a coffee, oh, pizza, mandolino. And I think how the say, okay,
part of the work we do here to convince
them. I know.
It's not only that.
Yeah.
We try.
One night a guy told me, "Oh, but you are cute. You don't have a mafia face." We didn't have sex. I promise you. We didn't have sex.
Yeah,
I promise you. He really said, "You are really cute. You don't have a mafia face." It's like, okay.
Are you supposed to feel flattered by that?
I guess so. You know, like,
oh, if it's for dinner, I hope that you say, "Oh, I'm so happy that you don't eat the cucumber on the pizza." No, what was the name? The ananas.
Ananas.
The ananas.
Pineapple on the.
Because in Italy we think that all the Americans eat the pizza with
pineapple.
Everybody.
So
if you go out for a cappuccino, whoa, with a piece of pizza and pineapple. And so it's the same thing. It's our way to do like pizza mandolino, you know.
In fact, everybody thinks that I have a cappuccino after dinner because I live in New York. I had a cappuccino after pizza when I was living in Naples. So it is a thing that I like, and I am Neapolitan. So stereotypes are both ways. But Gomorrah is also very modern for other things, because, for example, there was an episode that I had to take a stand, I decided, where there was Chanel, and Chanel, the wonderful Cristina Donadio that I adore, that was singing using her vibrator, and with this, and some guy, also because in Italy, I don't know if you know Stefano, but it's very popular, the mansplaining, men that has to explain how women has to feel. So this guy decided to make a big fuss about the fact that it was horrible for Neapolitan women to be, you know, like in a serious show that they had a vibrator. So I decided to make a movie of myself singing with my vibrator, singing Hypocrisia, and it was very viral. So it went viral. So Gomorrah is also very modern because it doesn't hold back, and there are a lot of, you know, of this. Can you tell about how
you,
the director? No.
Ah, okay.
How the, you know the scene.
I don't have.
Oh. I'm sorry for you.
No, I don't need.
No, but the problem is how Gomorrah defies it's very, the stereotypes. Yeah. Like because, for example, because, in this episode that was so much discussed all over social media and so on, but it presents a totally non-traditional representation, not only of Neapolitan women but of mafia women.
Yeah. But you know, it's the same thing that that I said before, that Gomorrah is a big metaphor of a lot of things. For example, that scene that I don't know if you remember, when Shanella sing this song with the vibrator, a song that talk about the hypocrisy, you know, the a lot of stereotypes too, you know, and it's a big metaphor about the thing that she was a single woman after the jail, that had no man in her life, don't need probably man in her life, and she showed to everybody these things with the vibrator. It's a big metaphor. It's not just like a woman that sing with a vibrator. For ignorant people, it's just like that. It's like the pizza and mandolino. It's the same thing. If you told that, we can show to the people that a woman sing with the vibrator, you are a stupid. Point.
Period.
I think we should start getting some questions from the audience. So if you have a question, raise your hand and
don't be afraid. I don't kill anybody because I need a green card.
Come vuole. Lei ha parlato di lei ha parlato di Gomorra come una metafora.
Certo.
No? E avete toccato adesso su uno dei protagonisti come parte della metafora. Ecco, che parte ha avuto lei stesso nella metafora?
Come personaggio?
Come persona.
Credo che la grande I think that the big metaphor about Jenny is how to grow up like a normal child, like the first Jenny was, in a family, in a mob family, that forced you to become a bad guy because they send him like a bad person in Honduras, and he was a normal guy that just wanted to fuck women and have motor, have cars, beautiful cars, you know. But they say, okay, it's finished this era. You have to kill for the first time with the Chiro a drug man, and then you have to go to Honduras to talk with the cartelos hondureños. That was one of the. I don't want to talk about because it's dangerous, but you know, and after he comes back like a demon. So what it mean that we talk about for Jenny with the biggest metaphor of a normal guy that was forced to become a demon, and what it mean that probably Jenny, if was grow up in a family of lawyer, for example, it don't become the monster that it becomes in season 2, 3, and 4. This was the biggest metaphor, I think.
Yes. Hi, how are you? I'm speaking English.
Yeah.
I'm your fan, Jenny. I'm your fan, Salvatore. I love you from the arms.
Thank you so much.
Your evolution as an actor is very inspiring for a lot of young people. But what I want to focus is, are you giving back to the community, for the youth? Are you going back to your Napoli, and are you going back and setting an example? Tell us a little bit about what's the message that you are trying to give back to your community. Thank you.
Thank you so much for all the compliments and
sorry, thank you.
If you say bad words, if you say it to me, one these wonderful words, I say thank you, really. This book is an example. This is not an autobiography. It talk about me, but especially what I want to say with this book is, if you have a dream, if you always have a dream, and you fight for him, and you go up a lot of bad things, and you think that that your dreams, you can realize your dreams, you can do it. If you grow up in a bad place, in a bad nation, in every place in the world, but if you have a dream and you fight for this dream, you can realize it. This is not 100% formula, but you can try. And if you can try, probably when you are older, you can say, okay, I tried to do this, and it can happen, but I tried. So this is the message of this book. For the other things, I think that I can do something, but the big problem is that me, a lot of association, a lot of people are alone. And you can fight a demon, a monster, like the poverty, like the angry people, like poor people, I say, alone. You need that the institution, that the states, that somebody's help you and them. In Italy, and I don't know if here the situation is different, that doesn't happen. So I think that alone I can do small things.
But to answer your question, the first chapter of your book, you talk about a visit to a pediatric oncological hospital where he goes, and of course the kids have not seen Gomorrah, fortunately, but the parents have. And so they spend time speaking with him for a little while, they are distracted, and then from one question of one of these mothers that tells you, Salvatore, but tell me something about yourself, not about Jenny Savastano. That's the question that triggered you to write the book. Yep. Her wanting to know who you really are. So it was one of these, during one of these moments in which you go back to your community and you try to do things that help bring a smile, bring some moment of solace for people in need.
Yeah, because I have to confess that I don't love to do these things. You know, a lot of hospitals, a lot of association needs me and calls me for to go to the hospital when there's a lot of child in a situation, an horrible situation, believe me. It's an hard work for me. And you say, okay, but you don't have the malattia.
Illness.
Yeah, you are safe. Yeah, but when you go in that place and saw this child small, it's hard, really, believe me. I understand that if I go to the hospital, probably the parents that have a lot of moment, a lot of minutes of happiness, you know, but it's really hard for me because I can do nothing, and this is the best. The worst thing that happened in a life, I think.
Feeling powerless.
Yeah. But I do something like that, and I hope that with my little help can help this family. Sometimes don't happen, but you know that the hospital situation is another problem. There's a lot of problem because you know they told me that if you have a child in hospital, the institution don't do nothing for you. A lot of family lose their job, lose their house for to pay for
the cures.
The cures. Yeah. So it's a lot of crazy situation that you say, but why? Why? And nobody gives you an answer.
Yes.
Ciao, sono Dario, mi chiamo Domenico, anche come lei sono un prego altri. Sono curioso a sapere come la
la tua una giornata tipica, come ti prepari per fare queste scene, come ti prepari mentalmente a fare la parte di un boss, o magari capita ogni tanto che
ammazzo qualcuno?
No. Che ti trasporti mentalmente, o magari ti senti male che hai fatto una scena, una sceneggiata che ti sei sentito molto emozionato, triste?
Ripeto la domanda. Domenico chiede a Salvatore come si prepara a girare le scene, quelle soprattutto più dure, e se qualche volta gli è capitato, dopo averla girata, le scene più difficili, più d'impatto, di sentirsi male o triste.
Thank you so much, Domenico, for this question. My teacher, Beatrice Bracco, told me every time that a good actor is the one that when the first assistant of director say action, the actor start. When the director say stop, cut, the actor stop his action, stop his emotional feels, stop everything. Because when I work on a script or on a scene in particular, I try to separate myself to Jenny, for example, in this case, because it's two different person. Jenny think in a way, Salvatore think in another way. And if Salvatore start to think like Jenny, or Jenny start to think like Salvatore, you don't believe in what I do in the scene. Because Salvatore think, oh my God, Jenny, but you are crazy. Why kill this person? Why you kill JJ with a watch? Why you do this? And if I do this, you saw in Jenny's eyes that Jenny don't believe in what he's going to do. So you don't believe in my characters. So I have to separate these two person. But I confess you that sometimes in a bad moment, in a very difficult scene, when I comes to the home, I have the idea and the emotional feels inside of me. But after a kiss of my girlfriend or a hug of
Paola,
my little
right
brother.
Here in the front row, please stand, Paola. Everybody can see Paola, please. Thank you.
I don't remember nothing, so this is.
Yes, sir. the question is on the freedom of the press in Italy. Piccole.
And? Thank you for this question, but I don't want to answer at this question. I just want to say that I think that one of the greatest problems of our nation, Italy, and I don't think just Italy, I think USA too, is that the politician and the journalist don't do well their job. And I know that it's I don't want to do, in Italy we say tutta l'erba un fascio.
A generalization,
you know, it's not a generalization, because I know that there's a lot of politics and a lot of journalists that do very, very, very well their job. But it's like me and the other person are alone. And if you work in a journal that is direct or paid from an editor that is like a politician, you fuck with me. So it's a joke. It's like I don't know, the president of a soccer team of Naples is supporter of Juventus. It's okay, cats. Okay.
I think he answered the question, right?
Actor?
Un regista.
No, I think yes. I think that cinema is another thing, and I hope so. I think for what I know, I think yes, because the problem of the cinema in Italy is just like if I take, for example, the France or the United States, is that in these 20 years, for example, they and us don't do a very union like there, for example. We are a syndicate, but it's nothing, you know. Here, the union of actor, directors, and scriptwriters had a lot of power. In Italy, no. I think this is the point. For the politically or something, I don't think. I think that the actors, actresses, and directors are free in Italy, or I hope so. Ah. Ah, Emanuele, come no? Sì, sì.
Sì, Emanuele, la mia domanda.
Sì.
Secondo te sarebbe possibile fare un film o una serie delle periferie di Napoli senza parlare anche della gomorra?
Ripeto la domanda. Sarebbe, ti chiami?
Zoe.
Zoe chiede se sarebbe possibile fare un film o un telefilm ambientato nelle periferie di Napoli senza parlare della camorra.
I think that it will be possible, of course. There is in Italy a very good soap opera called Un posto al sole, then talk about... Oh, why are you? Un posto al sole is a great soap opera.
Yeah.
Yeah, very successful, then talk about... Why? No, that talk about the good place of Napoli sometimes, and sometimes show bad things, a little small. It's not like Gomorra. For example, Gomorra had just one point of view, the bad point of view of the bad guys, and it's a choice, a director choice. You watch that, there's no too much policeman, because you watch everything that is going to happen, and never, if you were to kill a people, behind of you there's the policeman, oh, stop, I'm going to kill them. It's impossible, you know. Yes, I think that it can be possible. There's a lot of movie do it in the periferia. I think there's a lot, but if you want to talk of this situation and talk just of the good things, I think that it's difficult, because in a lot of this place, the good things, I think it's less than the bad things. I think there's a lot of good people in this place, but it's not too much. The bad person that do bad things is much more, I think. But I think it's possible to do something like that. And Postal Sole is beautiful. Why?
Ciao, mi chiamo William. Sono un grande fan anche americano.
Ah.
E volevo dire prima cosa che lo sviluppo di Jenny nella prima puntata, terza stagione, mostra un talento d'attore incredibile. E sono anch'io, ho anche una passione per le lingue, e mi chiedevo se per te tu volevi usare le tue lingue nella tua carriera d'attore, o se fosse una cosa a parte, e poi se hai delle ambizioni di avere una carriera internazionale come Benigni.
Ripeto la domanda di William, che è americano, grande appassionato di Gomorra, poliglotta anche lui, ama le lingue, e la domanda è se Salvatore pensa di usare le lingue che conosce per la sua carriera cinematografica, e se anche lui ha l'ambizione di diventare un attore internazionale.
Thank you so much, William. I always believed in destiny, you know? Because when I was six, I was with my grandpa, and I think in my mind, I remember it, one day I will become an actor, like that. After 1 year, we go in vacation in a village near in Puglia, There was the animation that is going to do a musical about Fred Buscaglione. I don't know if Fred Buscaglione is an Italian singer that looks like a gangster. You know, he sings the song to Eri Piccola, Piccola. It looks like a gangster. This is one of the keys of my life. And I was seven, and the animation is with the other guys. Okay, you have to do this. And in one day, I goes around with my bikes. Okay, I watch. I listen to the music. Okay. The second day, the same things. The third day, the same thing. The fourth day, one of these animators say, "Oh, little boy, you want to do this musical with us?" And I say, "Okay, just if I'm the protagonist, the main character." And she watched me like...
You had already watched The Godfather. You made them the offer they could not refuse, right?
And I'm looking in her eyes like that, and I say, "Oh, but okay, but tomorrow is the musical. You don't know the song, you don't know the ballad." And I say, "Yes, I know it." And I show her that in all this day, I listen on all the songs, and I know all the songs, and I know all the pace of the ballad just watching. And she was crazy, and I say, "Okay, you are the main character," and I do these things, and all the people, it's like crazy. So and I'm seven, so I was grow up with this dream. For another example, yesterday we talked about with a friend about the kick, or in this morning with the Tony. With my friend, with Italian friend here in New York, we talk about the kickboxing because I always love to do like kickboxing, martial art. But in my mind, I always have, okay, if I do this sports, my face, I don't know if one dream I want to become actor, I can do this because my nose, my eye. I don't know if you fight, but I'm a good person. But I can become bad.
You become pretty bad in war, indeed, yes.
No, but in my life, I can become like Jen. Not too much like Jenny, but something.
Oh, that's it.
So, now she knows. No, not with her. Not with her. If somebody touch her or my family,
then you become.
I can respond for myself. So I always say, no, I can do this because my face, you know, if I have to do this. And I was like 10 or 11. And the same thing is with, I goes to the liceo, come si dice qua?
High school.
A lot of my friends, you know, do tattoos for old bodies. And I say, okay, I like it, but... If I have to do the actor, I can do all these tattoos. And I say, what, do become an actor? But you fuck off. What do you think about? And I say, no, okay. And the real thing is that probably I don't like it very much. But I want to have a tattoo. And then I worked for a McDonald's from 18 to 24 for 6 years. And one day I come back at home and I talk with my grandpa that say, "But it's 3 o'clock, you can do this for all your life." I think about these things and I go to bed. I don't sleep probably. And in the morning I say to my mom and my dad, I want to follow my dream. I want to try to follow my dream. So. I left McDonald's and I goes to Rome and start to study acting. And after 3 years, I do Gomorrah. And after 5 years, I am here. So I believe in destiny. And you say if I love to do the career of the Italian actor that work in here with the industry, I hope so. It will be. I think that if you had a dream, you have to big. You have to dream bigger? You know, and my dream is to work with the best director, the best actor, for to compare myself as I'm a competitive. You know, I want to try. I want to do something better and better. So
you're on your way.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Do you have other questions? Yes.
Ciao.
Ciao.
Mi chiamo Yolanda. I'm an American, but my family's from Naples. My dad came here in the 70s from Santa Anastasia. And I just wanted to let you know that they came here to give us a better life and to have a better life for my parents and for us. And throughout my life, my parents have been trying to keep the Napolitan culture going. Numo piaciu presepe has been, we watched that so many times and we love it. And I have a 2-year-old daughter and I try to teach her Napolitan. When she does something bad, I say, tu cara, and she says to me back,
"Epterum bagab." It's wonderful.
But what I wanted to say is that I watched all these older things, but as an adult watching Gomorrah, it's a modern take on Naples, and it gives me a chance to see what it's like and why my family came here to give us a better life. And I think it's also...
It's not like that.
No. I know that. But I just wanted to let you know that it does give me that perspective. We go back to Italy all the time, and we see the beautiful things. Agostiera Amalfitana, and we...
A pizza, mandolina, yeah.
I stay with my mother's family in Salerno, and you know, I spent all my summers in Italy as a child, and I did study abroad in Rome for 6 months. But I just wanted to say thank you for giving us that modern perspective. But my real question is, when is season 3 coming to the United States?
So I have two answers for you. So thank you so much. È stata corta, non ti fa male, che sennò. The first answer is that Gomorrah don't give to anybody the perspective of Naples. Because the series is called Gomorrah, not Naples. You know, that's why, because I think that it's a biggest metaphor, Gomorrah. Because Gomorrah is like a cancer, you know? That this cancer is everywhere, in New York too, I think. And this cancer, in Naples, is called Camorra. In Sicily, it's called Mafia. In Brazil, it's called in another way. Here, it's called in another way. In some places, it's called politics, for example. But you know, Naples, it's totally different. And like every place in the world, that's zone d'ombra, come si dice? Dark space. There's dark space. In Brazil, there's the favelas. In USA, there's the ghettos. In Naples, there's this place. In Paris, there's the balier. In every place where the states, the politician or somebody took all the poor people, these poor people make up a crime organization because they have to eat. And the easy way for to eat is make money with drugs, with rubber, with kill people. And this easy way is not the good way. But if you have to eat, it's not a justification, but it's the same things that I told you before. Sometimes if you need a help and do like this, the first hand that you took is the mafia, the mob, the camorra, the criminal hand. That's the why. And Naples, I hope so that you enjoy yourself in Naples, not just in Costiera Amalfitana, Salerno, but in Naples. Because Naples is a beautiful place that every place in the world had a lot of problem. But the sun, the sea, and the pizza that you eat in Naples, you don't eat nowhere place in the world.
And I have to say that your book, on top of being your story, and you really talk about yourself with the degree of honesty and sincerity that is really admirable. But the thing that also emerges is that your love for your city. Yeah. And every corner you go through, your elementary school, the hospital where you go, you tell the story of these palaces as if they were part of your own personal history. These churches, these buildings become part of who you are. And so I think it's beautiful to see how you are in love with your city, and it shows in the book.
No, another thing is beautiful. Sorry, I have to do the second answer to your question. It's beautiful that you do this with your child, because my acting coach says the important thing is that wherever you go with your job, you don't lose your radici, your roots. Because it's these roots that let you understand who you are in every place in the world. So it's beautiful that you, your family, may grow up this child with these roots. You know, it's an honor for you. So thank you so much, like a Napolitan to an American Napolitan.
I wanted to add, he gave the perfect answer, but my last apartment in Naples was in Posillipo, so not in Scampia, but I moved here to give myself a better life. But I couldn't have make it without what Naples gave to me, that is culture, very high level culture. There are university and college that are, you know, that have a history and that are beautiful, and the humanity that you can find, the modernity, the strength, because you have to fight much more. There is so many similarities between New York and Naples that are amazing in so many things. There is the dark that gives you the opportunity to see the lights much better than if you live always in the lights. So if I am surviving here, thriving here, New York is my city. I have a tattoo here that says New York. But sometimes I can close my eyes and I can see myself on my Vespa going the wave from Posillipo to down early morning to go to work. That is my strength. Naples is also Gomorrah, but it's also everything that is opposite and is heroic. So I want to... My city is always in my heart. This is home for me. But Naples is everything I have. It's my skin and my blood and my words and my passion. And Naples made me able to survive everywhere.
Thank you, Angela. Grazie.
Anche se non parlo inglese, ma ho capito quello che ha detto.
No, in English. You have to talk in English.
Ma ci sono studenti che vogliono parlare italiano.
No,
lo faccio per
you
loro.
Have to talk in English.
Mi molo e mi sacrifico per questa cosa. Volevo dirvi una cosa
in
molto
this
seria.
Morning we do the travel with the helicopter.
Vi immagino.
You watch if you're going to watch the story, my stories on Instagram, you watch the face of Alessandra. It's scary, like. Okay, I'm not afraid, I'm funny.
Sono
not
fatto
afraid,
piccolo piccolo, non si direbbe, ma... Mi riallaccio ad una cosa e ci tenevo perché ho sentito anche adesso l'intervento di Angela. E, caro direttore, caro Stefano, nella tua prima domanda, diciamo, hai fatto cenno a questa cosa e l'hai chiesto. E volevo semplicemente soffermarmi sul paradosso. Io ho trovato un filo conduttore tra Napoli e New York ed è il paradosso. Queste sono due città che possono incarnare tante cose insieme, anche una differente dall'altra, che poi se ci riflettete, amici cari, è anche un po' la metafora della vita, l'esistenza e la coesistenza del bene e del male. Ora il punto è un altro, che Salvatore e la sua storia dimostra che noi abbiamo un potere, che è quello di scegliere. Salvatore non ha scelto Gomorra, sì, lo ha interpretato nella sua carriera artistica, ma quel che oggi conta è che siamo qui per parlare di una storia vita, di vita reale, in cui lui non ha scelto Gomorra, ma ha scelto la strada giusta. E io credo, e concludo con una citazione, credo di una donna a voi molto cara, Eleanor Roosevelt, che disse: il futuro appartiene a chi crede nella bellezza dei propri sogni. Salvatore, con la sua storia, ci ha dimostrato che a New York, come a Napoli, noi possiamo non solo inseguire, ma realizzare i nostri sogni.
Vero, grazie.
You need.
Grazie.
You need a mayor in New York? You need a mayor? Alessandro.
We have an almost Napolitan mayor already.
Oh, okay. I know. We need some politician
one
like
last
Alessandro.
Last question. Who's gonna? Yes, ma'am. Yes. Yes.
You.
Hi, welcome to New Yorker.
Thank you so much. Grazie.
Però vorrei commentare,
vorrei dirti delle parolacce. Mi vuoi dire delle parolacce? Cioè, i complimenti non li faccio, ti dico solo per.
Vorrei che parlassi in particolare del rapporto tra Jenny e Donna Emma, perché come mamma mi ha colpito moltissimo. Vorrei sentirti parlare un po' di questo rapporto molto particolare, molto affascinante, però non nel senso bello, ma nel senso brutto. Mi piacerebbe molto sentire cosa hai trasformato, cosa hai provato nella.
La domanda è sul rapporto fra Jenny e Donna Emma.
This is a beautiful question, Nikki, because this is one of the situation that we talk before about the metaphor. Because you know that in Naples and the south of Italy, I don't know if in America it's the same with the south, the relation between the mother and the male son, it's male son. Yeah. It's a world. It's very a world. And if you watch Natale in Casa Cupiello, it's the perfect description between the mother and the male son. In Gomorrah, we want to do this metaphor about a mother and a male son, a mother that don't like this son because it's not like them, like Donna Emma and Don Pietro, and his mind probably say, why is like that? Why is like that? He just want fuck old girls and want bicycles and cars. Why he don't want to kill people and make money with the drugs? Why? It's strange. It's strange. It's not like us. Why? So he needs to go in Honduras and become a slave for these cartelos. And after, when he come back, he looks like us. And Jenny comes back and kill probably his father with Chiro's help. And when his mothers die, he don't kill Chiro. So it's a big metaphor that if you want that your child or someone that you have to love become like you want, probably he become peggio, come si dice?
Worst.
So that's why I say that Gomorrah, it's not for everybody. It's not an easy series, because if you watch Gomorrah and say, oh, okay, you talk bad about Naples, fuck off, you are stupid. I told to everybody that give me this answer, and I say, okay, you are stupid, because you don't understand nothing about cinema, about series, about stories, about literature, about everything. So shut up, you're stupid. That's why, because I can talk with you about the relationship between Pietro and Donna Emma, about Chiro and Jenny, and in season 3 you will what you watch, it's not just like Jenny that killed Chiro, it's a great relation that grows up in the older season 3, and you say, okay, but Chiro kills Donna Emma and Jenny make kill Chiro, his father from Chiro. It's crazy. Why? Because you have to understand that the relationship between Chiro and Jenny is not like a friend. It's not like brothers. It's a love between these two men. That's not love. Okay, I want to fuck you. No, it's a dark love about these two guys that it's similar. That think the same thing, that want the same one. And when in season 3 Chiro comes back after he lose his son and his wife, hey, Jenny watching him and say, okay, you need my help. And when Jenny need help, need Ciro's help, Ciro give him. So it's another thing, another level. It's not just like love, friends, brother. It's a great metaphor. And if you watch Gomorrah like that, you understand something about cinema and series. If you're not, you can say to everybody, give you that answer about, okay, you talk bad about Naples. You say, okay, shut up, fuck off, you're stupid. Ciao. That's why.
And I think you gave Salvatore a beautiful and very deserved compliment.
I'm sorry for the bad words. but, you know.
He uses them more in English than in Italian.
Yeah, because I love when you, no, in Napolitan you can say a lot of bad things. Jenny talk very, very, but, you know, when you are in America, I love to say, fuck off. I don't know why. It's fun. You know?
He has a comic talent.
No.
And I think he should explore it more. But you all gave him beautiful and much deserved compliments for his talent as an actor.
Oh, we
but
do a direct, so we can put the boop, boop, and every time.
Beep every time you
no, yeah, no, it's direct.
You can be done.
Yeah, probably.
But I want to close with, I think it's the most beautiful compliment that an actor can receive. And it's something that your teacher, Beatrice Bracco, told you when you finished your career. And I thought about this sentence when I saw that in the trailer, the moment in which you hold the baby. And for a moment, it's the sweetest expression, most tender that you can see on anybody's face.
Jenny is sweet. And this is another thing. No, this is another thing, because everybody think that the mob people or a gangster, it's just like every time kill people, oh, you say, oh, I kill you. It's not like that. Giovanni Falcone, that was the greatest judge in Italy, killed by the mafia. See, I want to tell you something very, very dangerous. Sometimes mob people, mafia people, it's funny. They do a lot of barzellette.
Jokes.
It's funny.
Jokes.
They do a lot of jokes. It's funny. Because in every everyone think that these people is just like bad person, they want to kill people. No, the hard things to think about is that they are like us. You can find someone of them at the bar to take the coffee, and after he goes out and kill people. No, this is the reality. This is a reality. So if you saw Jenny that kiss his son and call him a Pietro in the same moment that he sent Ciro to kill his father, you say, oh, it's sweet, Jenny. Okay, but you don't think that it's let kill his father by Ciro. So,
but Beatrice saw all of this when you had still to start your career, and that's what she told you. Si vede che nei tuoi occhi hai la ferocia di chi ha lottato, vuole continuare a lottare e ha fatto tanti sacrifici per ottenere quei risultati, ma hai anche la dolcezza di un'anima buona e sensibile, e solo se hai una grande sensibilità puoi riuscire a capire le persone ed essere in grado di interpretare e creare personaggi sempre diversi. Beatrice, tonight is going to be very proud of you, wherever she is.
Thank you so much.